Hello, thank you everyone for coming and joining us for our Prescriptive Residential Wood Deck Construction Guide, or Design for Code Acceptance Number 6, also known as DCA 6 for short. I'm Lauren Ross. I was the staff principal in charge of updating this guide to the 2012 version. I'm seeing that it's not quite 2 o'clock yet, but I think we'll get going anyway. The first part of information we have is this poll question. And as you'll see, these poll questions aren't really something that we could grade on anyway. They're information as to, or more information for us more than anything else. So, Marcy, if you would launch the poll question.
Okay, here we go. The first poll question, and I see great, some of you are already answering, and the first poll question is, what is your profession? Architect, engineer, code official, building designer, or other? I'll give you a couple seconds here to answer. Alrighty, let's go ahead. Alright, it looks like about 58% are engineers, 27% code officials, and just a little bit of everybody else. So, alright, thank you for sharing, everyone.
Thank you. The next poll question we have is really a question about how familiar are you with DCA 6. Are you familiar with the 09 version, or have you ever used it before?
All right, so have you used the 2009 DCA 6? Have you never used the DCA 6, or have you never even heard of the DCA 6? All right, it's looking like the majority of people have never used the DCA 6, small majority, about half, and 36% have used the 2009 DCA 6, and 23% have never even heard of the DCA 6, so pretty even.
Okay, thank you so much for sharing. That's good information for us for knowing how to address the audience. So there's free downloads with this presentation. There's free downloads with this presentation. The DCA 6 itself can be downloaded here, and there's going to be links in the chat box. And this presentation can be downloaded as well at the following location. Why are decks important? They're one of the most dangerous parts of your house. And nearly 15% of all injuries are from decks or result from structural failures. About two-thirds of those are what's seen in this picture right here, where the deck falls away from the house just because of the ledger. And another third are about the railing failures. I think Dr. Frank Wiestey, puts it best. That says, except for natural disasters, basically, that there's more injuries with decks than other load cases combined. So the objectives of today are to first identify the changes to DCA 6 2012, and then we're going to talk about the minimum prescriptive requirements for basically the scope of DCA 6. And then we're going to talk about the meat of DCA 6, the material, how it's used, the minimum material requirements. Then Buddy's going to come in and he's going to talk about resources that you have if you're designing a deck and you go beyond the scope of DCA 6. And there's going to be some deck design examples kind of scattered throughout the presentation. It's kind of to show you exactly how this thing works. Okay? So the changes. The changes were made basically through the American Wood Council as the primary author of the document, but also in conjunction with the ICC, International Code Council, in Fairfax County, Virginia. But that wasn't all of them. We also had help from APA, NHB, a slew of individuals that helped contribute to this. Obviously, the biggest change was updating to the 2012 IRC. And in the document, in DCA 6 itself, you'll see these bracketed text, which references the actual section in the IRC. And those are the requirements in the IRC that are mandated. But DCA 6 goes beyond IRC in certain instances. It's designed to meet or exceed the IRC minimum requirements. It's supposed to fill in some of the gaps that aren't there in the IRC. And those are considered best practices. But if there's a conflict between the IRC and DCA 6, the IRC applies since it's the actual code. Obviously, DCA 6 is not intended to preclude the use of other materials or construction methods. We had to list out a method of doing things, not necessarily the method of doing things. Just because we had to do a method of doing things just because it's a prescriptive document. As always, construction and materials need to be approved by the authority having jurisdiction. A great way of doing that is by making it meet the National Design Specification for Wood Construction, or NDS, which Buddy will be talking about later. So some specific examples of the changes. Okay? So you have hold down tension devices are on all decks. That's new to the 2012. And we'll be talking in detail about all of these later in the presentation. We're just kind of highlighting them right here. Aspect ratio of 1:1. Basically, the length and width have to be, or the length cannot be larger than the width. Post height based on tabulated values. Basically, the post height is based upon the tributary area of it, instead of just saying it's 14 feet like it was in DCA 609. No hollow masonry concrete connections to ledgers. You'll see that later in the presentation. It's just a connection issue. 2x6 joists are added due to popular demand. I-joist details were added for that hold-down connection device. Overhang tables were manipulated and changed how they're presented. Glue laminated timber beams were added, so now you have that option. More footing options were added so that you have more options as to what kind of footings you need can use. And footing braces or knee braces were added or were changed how they're used slightly in the document. So those are the changes. Let's kind of go over the minimum prescriptive requirements of DCA 6. Okay? And then we'll talk about the meat of it and do the other things. When we're talking about the minimum requirements, we're talking about single-level residential decks only. So hot tubs, things like that are outside the scope. Basically, anything that makes you so you exceed the 40 PSF load that was designed for is going to make it so that you are outside the scope of the DCA 6. As always, decks shall not be used till final inspection and alternate methods are allowed. Also, lumber has to be a grade marked and approved lumber, and it needs to be naturally durable or preservative treated. And we have a table that's a revised table from the last time that kind of gives this table one that gives uses or how species can be treated for and what its use can be. So now let's get into the kind of the meat of the document. I learn best from examples, so that's exactly what we're going to do, is kind of run through an example and kind of go through the meat of the document itself. Now, you build from the bottom up, but you design from the top down, because that's how loads work. So that's what we're going to be doing. So this example, we have a deck height of 1 foot 6 inches, not that far off the ground, an 8x12 deck surface, not that big. Southern pine, 5/4 inch radiance, southern pine decking, and we're just going to design it. We're going to figure out the joists, the beams, hangers, footings, all of that information, all based off of DCA 6. Okay? So the decking first, very top part. We can use 5 1/4 inch radius decking, or you can use 2 inch nominal decking. It doesn't matter. Just has to be, you have to follow the ALSC span decking policy. Attachment with 2 number 8 common nails or 2 number 8 screws. And yeah, there's spacing requirements, and the decking can be either perpendicular or 45 to the joists. And it has to bear on a minimum number of 3 joists, which is new to the 2012. Used to be 4 joists. Substitution allowed, of course, by a building official. Now, when we're talking about that attachment, we're talking about those screws or nails, we're talking specifically about threaded nails, so either helical or annular nails that won't work out during moisture cycling. And screws and lag bolts also have their own standard that they need to conform to. Bolts and lag screws are 1/2 inch, and they're prescriptively used extensively through this document as the 1/2 inch size. And everything's sized, all the connections are spaced and sized around that 1/2 inch bolt or lag screw. So if you substitute a different size bolt, if you go larger, say, then your spacing needs to be adjusted. You can't just go with a larger bolt or lag screw and expect to have higher capacity, because you could be introducing new modes of failure into it by having less spacing in that. So bigger doesn't necessarily mean better. It means you need to readjust. All the connectors, things need to have corrosion resistance, especially if you're in a saltwater exposure, they need to be stainless steel. And you need to be aware of flashing requirements too. So below the decking and their connectors are the joists. And there's 3 options for joists. You can have an overhang on one side, so you can have it connected to the house and then have an overhang on one side. Or you can have an overhang on both sides, so it's still connected to the house, but it's not relying on the house for vertical load. It has this second post, or this closer post to the house. And this is a slight revision in terminology from the 09. We're calling this a non-ledger deck. So it's still connected to the house, but it's for lateral support, but for vertical loads, it's working independently of the house. Or you have what we're using in our example, which is a simple span beam, just goes from the beam right to the house, nothing too complex, joist hangers on both sides. All you have to do is you look up in the table and you say, look, for our example, we want 8 foot span. What size can give me an 8 foot span? And you look and you say, a 2x6, 16 inches on center can do that for me. And this is, again, new to the 2012, is this 2x6 size. You'll notice that footnote 6 there. That's saying that the ledger board still needs to be a 2x8 in the outside joist if you're up off the ground and you need railings, it still needs to be a 2x8. Okay. Also new to the 2012 is the allowable overhangs are more clearly defined. For those of you that are familiar with the 09 version, it used to be that there was an allowable span for those without cantilevers and those with cantilevers, or those with overhangs. And then you just said, well, you can allow an L over 4. This is a little different format. It's more clearly understood, we believe, and it's a little more flexible. Also, for those that are familiar with the 09 version, you might be familiar with the erratas. There's new southern pine design values, and those were incorporated into the erratas into the or addendums, excuse me, addendums into the 09. And they are now just built right into the main document of it. So these tables reflect the new southern pine design values. What are those joists designed for? They're designed for a 40 PSF uniform live load and a 10 PSF uniform dead load. And it's assumed number 2 grade, L over 360 deflection, wet surface conditions because we're outside, and if there are, for some species, they're incising. And we'll talk about what incising means in just a bit. For the overhangs, we're doing an L over 180 deflection limit. L over 180 meaning the larger span being the L, and a 220-pound point load at the end. Now, this isn't on top of that 40 PSF live load. This is as alternate to the 40 PSF live load, so it's another condition you have to check. You can also check your spans with our online span calculator, which can be used for simple spans, uniform loads, and it can do wet service conditions and incising factor. One thing to note, though, is that you should not be doing anything above 18 feet, because that's the limit of DCA 6. That's the limit of DCA 6 simply because we don't want the footers to go too large. So the joist, the online calculator, can spit out values that will give you larger than 18 feet, but DCA 6 is going to rein you back in and say, no, you shouldn't do more than 18 feet. So incising, that sizing has something to do with what we call refractory species, which is dug fir, larch, hem fir, spruce pine fir, so mostly West Coast species. What it is it's going through, the board goes through and does these little nicks on the board, and that's so that the chemical can penetrate into the wood a little bit further, and so that it can actually get adequate penetration to preserve treated. And it does reduce the strength of stiffness, so we have to take that into account when we're designing. And that's already taken into account in our tables, and you can take it into account on our online span calculator right there. One side of the joist is going to be the ledger. Okay? So this is what the ledger detail looks like in the IRC. It's pretty straightforward. Very similar. Ours has, and you can see why a 2x8 is still necessary because of the spacing requirements. You could do a ledger to a concrete or solid masonry wall, but again, you can't, this new change to the 2012s, you can't do it to hollow masonry units. That's because you just don't know the strength of the hollow masonry units, and we don't know how well you can fill in the hollow masonry units. So we decided to go against that route. It was decided to go against that route. The ledger requirements for the rim joist inside the house, whether you can do a ledger or not, is going to be partially dependent upon what the rim joist is inside the house. If it's a solid sawn wood, you can go ahead and do that. If you have eye joists, then you might have an engineered wood product rim joist. If it's 1 inch or over, you're golden. You can use a ledger. So that could be an engineered wood product, might be an OSB oriented strand board or a structural composite lumber, including a laminated veneer lumber. If it's less than 1 inch, then you need to go to a non-ledger deck. It needs to be vertically independent of the house. Or if you're like my house and you have trusses on your floors, then you're probably going to have this 2x4 ribbon right there. And it's not designed to hold a deck. So you can't attach to it. You need to do a freestanding deck in that situation. Other instances when you need to have a freestanding deck is when you have exterior veneers, because they're just not designed to hold up the weight of a deck. So brick veneer, masonry veneer, stone veneers, they all require a non-ledger deck. Other things are a cantilever floor. That floor is already being stretched out, and you don't want to add an extra point load at the end of the floor. So we just don't want to see that. It requires a non-ledger deck. So for that ledger, the IRC gives a table that looks like this for the spacing of the bolts that are needed. That's based on a testing that was done at Virginia Tech and Washington State University, where they tested half-inch diameter lag screws and bolts. And that's why it needs to be done exactly the way it's prescribed exactly. It's because it's a tested value, not a engineered value. So it has to be followed exactly. And these are some of the limitations it has. You'll notice that there's no decay present or fastener corrosion in it because it's a laboratory condition. So if you've got those, then you're outside the bounds of the limited testing. So you need to do something else. We give a similar table. It's basically has engineered wood products and a stacked washer option. Still the half-inch lag screw bolts. So how you read this table is you just look in. We had, we're going to assume for our example, 2x10 slitter pine rim board for our house. We're going to have a 2x8 southern pine ledger because we have to have at least a 2x8. And our joist spans were 8 feet, so you just go down and say, oh, I have lumber for my rim joist, so I get to do 23 inches on center. And what that does, this is the IRC table that says exactly how the bolts are spaced. That does is that gives you the spacing of the bolts from here to here, or like in our figure, it says right there, C table 5. And these spacings are right out of the NDS, the National Design Specification for Wood Construction. And so again, they're all sized for a half inch, but that's what the testing was. So it's all related to each other. And it's very prescriptive as to exactly what it needs to be to prevent cross-grain bending, splitting, all of that. The lag screws, again, half inch diameter, and they need to extend half inch beyond the band board. If you actually tried to engineer this connection, you'd see that it doesn't work. There's not enough penetration into the band board or rim joist to make it work. So what they did is they said, we're going to get it so it extends beyond, but we're going to get it past this tip and into the threaded section. We're just going to make it so it gets all the penetration we can have and figure it out from there. So that's why that requirement's there. And sadly, we have to talk about making sure it's done with pilot holes and inserting by turning and not hammering and things. So these are those lateral hold down devices, and there's going to be one at each end of the deck. This is the detail on the 2012 IRC, and our details are very similar. The biggest difference is that we've got ours so that they can be sloped away from the house to allow drainage to condensation to drip down away from the house. And we also have I-joist details of how to do it with an I-joist, not just solid sawn. So this is a poll question we've got to make sure that you've been paying attention. And It's basically, when are the lateral tension devices required?
Tension. Cool. Are we all set? For the DCA-6, lateral tension devices are required depending on the size of the deck, depending on the height of the deck, if knee braces are not installed, if the deck is a non-ledger deck, or always. Right. Let me share those responses. 76% say always.
Good. That's what I was hoping. So yeah, it's always required in DCA 6 2012. That was a decision that was basically made to make it so that IRC says that you either have to design for lateral loads or you have to use those lateral devices, and with an infinite possibility of sizes and shapes of decks with DCA 6, you had to go into the area of saying that those lateral devices are needed. So also new to DCA 6 2012 is that we have details for when the house joists run perpendicular to the joists of the deck. And that was a detail originally developed by WJMA. Other end of the joist now, finally. It's a lot simpler. Is a simple rim board and simple attachments with nails or screws. Okay. And there's three options for attaching the joist to the beam below. And there's simple toenails, a connector, or like in what we're going to be using, a joist hanger. Okay. Important thing is to make sure that you have recognized that these connections are designed so they can take uplift, because you have that 220 pound on the overhang, and then they're going to be, which is going to cause an uplift load over at the end. So we have, for our joist hangers, we have a table that specifically says what the capacity of that joist hanger needs to be. And it's based off the joist size. So we have 2x6s. It needs to be 400 pounds in capacity. Pretty simple. Our beams are the next thing down. They can overhang L over 4, or in other words, this length that's from post-faced to post-faced divided by 4 over. The internal splices. The big important thing, though, is that joists cannot be attached to opposite sides of the same beam. And that's just because of how the tables are derived. It's purely a tributary area situation. They can overhang the beam, but you can't have simple span, simple beam, simple span. So, and we'll talk about how to get around that limitation with the commentary and with the NDS. So for ours example, what you could do is you could look and say, look, my joists span 8 feet. I want to use 2 2x8s. And I look and I say, oh, even with overhangs, that doesn't quite get me there. Let's try 3 2x8s. 3 2x8s will get you there. I'll use an 8-foot span with two 2-foot overhangs. And 2 2x10s also work, but because I'm so low to the ground, I'm going to be using 3 2x8s. New to the 2012 is also glue laminated timber beams, and we'll talk and use that table in a bit. How to stitch up your beam, how to make your beam, multi-ply beam work together as a unit is also covered, and that's right out of the IRC. the post requirements, 6x6 or larger. We're hoping, or is required, we're hoping in the commentary to cover 4x4 posts, but we haven't gotten the commentary out yet. They need to be centered on footings, cut ends need to be treated. And you can either do a post cap like this, or you do a notched in connection like that. And what you do can depend on your beam. So if you have a 3x or 4x beam or a 2-ply beam, you can do a notch in. But if you have a 3-ply beam like what we've got, then you need to do a post cap. The point is to have wood-to-wood bearing. What you don't want to see is this situation where they're just slapped onto the side with a connection. And the point is that there's no wood-to-wood bearing, so it's all mechanical. And with the wet surface factor and wet surface conditions, you can split the wood. It's just not as strong of a connection. So we don't want to see that. Below the posts are the footings, and these are the footing options in DCA 6. You can see the two new ones from the 2012. We assume a soil bearing capacity of 1,500 PSF, which is pretty low, but that's the default value in the IRC, and we're hoping to have other values that are options in the commentary when that comes out. The post height and footing sizes are given in a table 4. The post heights are how they're handled are new to DCA 6. 2012. So they're based off of this beam span and joist span, basically the tributary area. And they work something like this. We have our joist span is actually 8 feet, so that's less than 10 feet. Our beam span was 8 feet, so we go over and says southern pine can go up 14 feet. Well, that's a 6x6 post, 14 feet. That's easily going to handle my small little deck. And then I look over here for footing sizes, and I can see my footing, if I use a round diameter footing, I have 20 and 18 by 18, and 8 inches thick. Now, of interesting to note, new to 2012, is this footnote 2, which says the value may be multiplied by 0.9 for corner posts. Well, that's all we have in this case. We don't have any middle posts. We only have two corner posts. So this value isn't 20, it's 20 times 0.9, or 18 times 0.9, or 8 times 0.9. It can be, you have the ability to decrease that because the corners don't have as much tributary area. They're not carrying as much as a middle post would be. The commentary, when it gets published, will give you the equations for designing the footings, just as the previous version did. But one thing to note is that we now include the dead load of the concrete as we didn't before. So the footing sizes are actually a little bit larger now than they were. Guardrail attachments were under 30 inches, so a guardrail is optional for this deck, for our example deck. So we won't do it, but we'll do it in the next example. So you come to this figure in the design aid, design for code acceptance, DCA 6. And this is where you can write down, this is the heart of the document, this is where you can write down all of the information that you've designed for. And this is where you can write it down and go to the counter and say, this is my deck. Or if you're working with a customer, you can help them and say, look, you need to go to table such and such, and that will size this for you, or whatever it needs to be. One thing to note is that when I talk about the aspect ratio, remember that's being new to 2012, is that the width cannot be greater, or the width has to be greater than the length. And how I remember this is almost like your nose. It's projecting out. It's the width of your nose versus the length of your nose. And that's the reason we went with width and length in those directions. So this next example is a little more complicated. So it's 8 feet off the ground, as a 16 by 20 deck. We're going to use a glue laminated beam, and we're framing around a bay window. So real quick, it's the same process for doing the joists. This time we're going to be using a 2x10. We're trying to get 16-foot span. So we look at this, we say, hey, look, we can do 14-foot span, and then we can do a 2-foot overhang. So I won't even need the 3'5" overhang. I'm just going to use 2 feet of that overhang. For beams, I'm going to go down and I'm going to use a glue laminated beam. And I'm going to use this 3.5 by 14 inch. Remember my joist spans were 14 feet. So I'm going to go over and I'm going to use this one right here, which gives me I can go up to 15 feet 5 inches. So I'm going to end up using a 14 foot span with 2 3-inch overhangs, because I can use that divided by 4 as an overhang. So I can easily go 3 feet. Posts and footing, it's the same thing. Remember, I have 14 by 14, which means that I can go up to for my southern pine 11 feet in my post height. I don't need that much, so I'm fine. And again, I have my footer sizes, and since again I only have corner posts, I can multiply them by 0.9. Here's where it really starts getting different, is framing around that bay window. So framing around a bay window, you can only go up to 6 feet wide, the 6 foot maximum, right? And if you have more than that, you need to put a post in to reduce that width. The trimmers on it, you need to have a triple trimmer if it's 12 inches or 16 inch joist spacing, or if the spacings or the spans are over 6.5 feet. You can use a double if it's 24 inch joist spacing or spans less than 6.5 feet. And that A direction is how far that length, it's how far that bay window or whatever it is sticking out. So in our case, we need to have triples because we're spanning more than 8'6", and also our joist spacing requires it too. So we look down and we can say, look, we're using a joist of 2x10s. Our minimum capacity is for our hangers is 1410. So that's for this hanger right here, right up against the house. And it gives us that value as well. Also, since the deck is more than 2 feet above grade, we need to have knee braces. And this is different in 2012 than it was in the previous DCA 6. So we have to have diagonal braces, and it's only diagonal braces that are parallel to the beam. We don't require them perpendicular to the beam. And we don't require them, in fact, don't recommend them on middle posts, because that would be adding extra load into the middle post that it just wasn't designed for, because the middle post already has more vertical load on it. The knee braces are there just to add a little bit of stiffness. Okay. Guard requirements, they have to be 36 inches, and that's measured from the adjacent fixed location. So something like this needs to be 36 inches from the seating, not from the floor. So you don't want to see something like that. The guardrail requirements is for decks greater than 30 inches in height, but the important part is that you do not notch the posts. And that comes from a test, again, out of Virginia Tech research. They loaded this thing. What happens is this thing has to support 200 pounds with a 2.5 factor of safety, so basically 500 pounds. And if it was notched or if it had just normal bolts, then it failed. But commercial hold downs worked. It actually worked. So we have details for it, for both if it's if the railing is running parallel with the joists or perpendicular with the joists. One thing of note is for those familiar with the C sub D factor or the load duration factor, we're assuming it's a 1.6 for this, which is a question we sometimes get. And this is if the deck running is running perpendicular to the joist right here. The detail. Also, you can ask stair requirements, and DCA 6 covers those. It says the rise and the run for it, how large of a space you can have in between your risers. But it covers basically all of this. And it covers your stringers, how large of a span your stringers can be. So for our example, we have an 8-foot high deck, and if you figure out the math, that requires a 10-foot 4 solid stringer, because solid stringers can go 13 feet 3 inches, so we're okay. We can use a solid stringer. Stringers are attached using this sloped joist hanger, again, to provide some bearing that was decided to be the best. On the other side of the stringer is this kind of interesting detail. The idea was to, again, provide wood-to-wood connection. So what you're seeing here is you're seeing the stringer come down, and it's bearing on this block that's attached to the post. So it's literally right there where the red cross-section is. So that's the stringer. And what that is to prevent the bolts from having to take it, because it's a known failure mechanism if the bolts are taking all the action, to have that split, the stringer just split. Stringers, treads, all of those are sized for you in DCA 6. For example, we're using solid stringer, southern pine, so we need to use 2x8s, which is actually new to the 2012. I believe it was 2x6s before. And again, we come to this figure, which we can use for with our clients or with the building official to make it show them exactly what we're meaning and what we're trying to do. It also has details for handrails, what's allowed, what's not allowed, and what grip sizes. It has all of that. One thing that I want to stress is that if you are wondering about information in DCA 6, the best place to look is the commentary. The commentary gives background information. It tries to be transparent in what we did with DCA 6. It gives example calculations. And to some extent, it gives alternatives to the prescriptive provisions. So for example, when we talked about how the beam can only have joists spanning in one side, right? Well, the commentary talks about how you can get around that by saying, by using an equivalent in the table. So say if I had joists, 8-foot joists coming in from both sides, I could use 16 feet in the table, and that would make it so that it's an equivalent tributary area, and it would know that. So that kind of gets into a little bit of other resources you have for if you exceed the prescriptive limitations of DCA 6, in which case I'm going to hand it over to Buddy Showalter at this point, who can take it from here. Sorry, I can't hear you, buddy, if you're talking.
Okay, thank you, Lauren. I had my mute button on there. Sorry about that, folks. But we're going to proceed here with looking at some resources that are available for the case where you may have exceeded the provisions or the requirements of DCA 6. Where do you go from there? There are design standards available that are referenced by the building codes, and this one shown on your screen is the National Design Specification, or NDS, for wood construction, and it contains structural lumber design values. It also contains engineering provisions for column design, beam design, connection design. We also have design values for glued laminated timber that's new now to the DCA 6. And so a lot of what is developed in DCA 6, if it's not developed prescriptively in the IRC, the International Residential Code, has its basis in the NDS. Footing design, on the other hand, since that's concrete and we're a wood organization, is per engineering mechanics. And so we've had some partners with ICC and other building officials who've helped develop the footing design provisions of DCA 6. So I believe we've got another poll coming, so I'm going to ask Marcy to come back and lead you through this next poll.
Okay, here we go. So, which of the following statements apply? You can choose as many as apply this time. So, some of you may have read both of these or none of these. I've used the 2012 NDS. I've used the 2005 NDS. I've never used the NDS, or I've never even heard of the NDS. Go ahead and submit your vote. I'll give you a couple seconds here. Let me share that. All right, so about 56% of you have used the 2005, and about 28% have used the 2012, and 27% never have used it, and 10% have never even heard of it. So we are good to go.
All right, thanks, Marcy. That's really helpful for us, as Lauren said, knowing our audience and how to walk through these provisions. So let me talk a little bit first about the supplement to the NDS. The NDS comes in a package which includes the design provisions, which is the main document, also includes this supplement with design values for lumber, and glued laminated timber and other products like that. For the purposes of deck design, dimension lumber is specified, and so that's either going to be a rectangular or square cross section, 2 to 4 inches thick for your joists. For your beams and stringers, then we have 6 by 6 and larger, and those are graded according to a little bit different provisions. The posts and timbers apply to 5 by 5 and larger, and those are nearly square in cross section. So within the design values supplement are a series of tables that have bending, tension, shear, compression perpendicular to grain, compression parallel to grain, modulus of elasticity. And so these are the properties that are used in the engineering calculations to size the joists and the beams. Specific gravity is used for determining connection design values. And so as you can see here, that's spelled out for different softwood and hardwood species. The predominant species that are used for decks are what we've spelled out in DCA 6. So let's talk a little bit about how we determine bending design values and bending properties for joists and beams. The F sub B value measures the fiber stress and bending, and so tests are performed on wood members to determine those bending design values. And closely related to that is the modulus of elasticity. The bending strength is a strength property, and that will give you a level of safety against failure. The modulus of elasticity is a stiffness property that is used to calculate deflection, and so those are the two properties you get based on a load like this. Compression parallel to grain is as shown here in this graphic, and this is where we use compression design values to size our columns for DCA6. And Lauren touched on the new column table, the post table in DCA6, and the maximum length is 14 feet, but then we are going to use these compression parallel values to determine maximum post sizes based on tributary area. Then we have a series of adjustment factors in each table of the NDS, starting in Chapter 4, which is for lumber. You'll see tables very similar to this that show what adjustment factors apply to some of those design properties that we just talked about. So bending design values, for example, are modified by wet service factor, C sub M, the beam stability factor, C sub L, if it's an unbraced beam. The joists are typically going to have decking attached to the top, and so those will be assumed to be fully laterally supported. One of the questions that came in while Lauren was speaking was, well, what about hidden fasteners? Sometimes with the composite decking, you've got grooves in the side of the decking, and you've got these hidden fasteners that would allow the decking to slide around, basically. And so in that particular case, you probably have to assume that the joist is unbraced, because if the decking's allowed to move, then it really doesn't brace the compression edge of the joist, and so you'd have to design it as an unbraced member if you have those types of composite connections. Size factor is used to size different joists. 2x12 are the baseline design values, and so you'll have different adjustment factors all the way up to 2x4. The incising factor we'll talk about in a little bit is for hard to treat species, and then repetitive member factor as well. So we have these different properties that all then have adjustment factors, and we'll show you an example here in a second, but load duration is also one of the adjustment factors, and wood has a unique property in that it's able to carry a much higher load over a shorter period of time. And so let's jump down here to the impact load duration factor, which is in the 10-second range or less. And so you see, impact's probably even less than 10 seconds. But for an impact load, you can actually double your values, your strength values, like bending, tension, compression, based on that load. Now, for a deck, since it's comparable, or the loads that we use are comparable to a living space, like a first floor of a structure, first floor of a house, we use 40 pounds per square foot for our live load, and so we use this occupancy live load duration factor of 1. So as you can see here, the snow load duration factor is 15%. This actually means that if you are designing for a uniform snow load of 40 pounds per square foot, that the designs that we have for joists and beams are actually conservative, because you could bump those design values up for snow by 15%. So for a uniform snow load of 40 PSF or less, you can use DCA 6 as well. The tricky situation that I think Lauren alluded to is if you have sliding snow or drifting snow on the deck, that makes it a lot more difficult to calculate. So then it becomes more of an engineered design. And so you can imagine with a sloped roof, snow shedding off of that sloped roof right onto the deck, that you could have some drifting issues as well. So in high snow load areas where you're going to have your structures are prone to a lot of snow and drifting, then you probably need to look for an engineered design, because that's outside the limits of DCA 6. That load duration curve looks something like this, and as you can see, it becomes asymptotic here as we get past the 10-year load duration up to a permanent load. And so that's that occupancy load of 1.0 is going to be in this range here, and then you see that ramps up for some of those other loading conditions that we talked about. We talked about the size adjustment factor and the fact that the 2x12s, the 12-inch row here next to my cursor, is really the baseline. So for a 2x12, your size adjustment factor is 1, and then you can see that that goes up 10%, 20%, all the way up to a 50% increase for 2x4 materials. So since DCA 6 is limited to 2x6 or less, 1.3 would be the max adjustment that you would see if you were doing an engineered application for those joists. I mentioned the repetitive member factor, C sub R. And that allows you to take a 15% increase, 1.15, for 2 to 4 inch dimension lumber. So these are your decking joists, 24 inches on center or less, which would also include your built-up beam. So if you have a 3-ply beam or joists at 24 inches on center or less, with a load distributing element. And so the decking, as we mentioned, can be used as the load distributing element if you're nailed into the top edge of the joist, to make sure that you're distributing load between all three of those joists, then you can bump up your bending design value by that 15%. And so, as I mentioned, that applies to both joists and your built-up beams. Wet surface factor, C sub M, is applied to outdoor applications, like this one you see here, where you've got a pedestrian walk of some sort out over not only open water, but in an exposed environment where rain can wet those wood products. And so if you have those wet use conditions, you're going to take a reduction on your bending design values, your shear design values. Compression perp actually gets the biggest hit. That's a 1/3 adjustment on compression perp, and your compression parallel values and E values are also going to be adjusted. So that kicks in as well for outdoor applications. The incising factor applies to products that we say are hard to treat, or the fancy name is refractory species. And so for Douglas fir, hem fir, SPF, those species don't absorb the chemical treatments as readily as, say, a southern pine that's shown here in this stack. And so what they have to do is cut small incisions into the sides of the timber to allow the preservative treatment chemicals to penetrate to the depths that are required by the AWPA standards. And so when you cut those incisions into the edge of the timbers, that basically cuts wood fiber. And so to account for that wood fiber that's been cut in the outer perimeter of the wood member, you've got these adjustment factors for E, your adjustments for strength, bending, tension, compression, and shear, and then no adjustment for compression perp, because it doesn't affect that property. And so incising factors, if you're designing decks out west, or in some of the northern areas of the U.S., you may see those treated products that would require an incising adjustment factor. So let's look at an example. Let's say that you're designing a deck outside of DCA 6. You're using the NDS, and so you want to get an adjusted design value to use for your design of a number 2 grade 2x8 Hemford deck choice. 16 inches on center. It's got that incising that we mentioned just a second ago to get the chemicals to penetrate. Need a wet use factor. And so we go to the table in the NDS supplement that we talked about, and the bending value for Hemfer is, the base value is 850 PSI. So then there's a size adjustment factor of 1.2. We talked about that. Wet service factor ends up being 1.0 here. And the reason is, let me see if I can scroll back up to that wet service adjustment. There is a footnote here that says if your bending value times your size factor is less than 1150, C sub M equals 1. So in this particular case, for our HEM-FER example, that 850 times 1.2 is less than that threshold. So the wet service factor doesn't actually kick in here, but for some of the other species, it does. But the incising factor does apply, the 0.8 factor. The repetitive member factor applies, and so we take that 850 bending design value and adjust it by these factors that we've determined from the standard, and we come up with 938 PSI. That's the actual design bending strength that we use to calculate joist spans for a 2x8, and so that's what you see here in these particular tables. So that's an example of how to calculate a design value. Now, another tool that we have that is available for free download from our website is called Span Tables for Joists and Rafters. This document's been around for many, many decades, and it's a little bit more difficult to use than, say, a simple calculator or prescriptive table like we have in DCA 6, but it does give you a lot of flexibility to size floor and ceiling joists and rafters for a whole lot of loading conditions. So not only the 10 PSF dead load that we have in DCA 6, but it covers all the way up to 20 pounds per square foot dead load, goes up to 60 pound per square foot live loads, and then covers a lot of other deflection criteria as well. Now, these are for simple span applications. So if you have a cantilever condition, we'll show you some other tools that you can use for that. But once you know how to use those adjustment factors that we just talked about in our example in the previous slide, you can apply the size factor, repetitive member factor, load duration, wet service, and incising. You go into then this span table for joists and rafters using bending and E values to determine what your safe allowable span is. And so you can use that to size joists for deck applications, because you can apply that wet service factor and incising factor before you enter into this table. So the design values for joists and rafters also are tabulated to make it a little bit easier to see what those design values are for, includes the size adjustment factor in it for some of the other species like Hemfer. And again, that's free on our website. The other thing available there is a tutorial that walks you through how to use those span tables and gives some examples there if you're interested in using this document. So then Lauren mentioned the AWC online span calculator. Again, this is for simple spans, not for cantilever conditions. So it does give you a tool to use for that, for uniform load conditions, but you can take the wet service conditions and the incising factor shown here and here. So once you've plugged those in for your particular joists and rafters, then you can calculate a span note here that the span for this southern pine species has the new southern pine design values that were effective June 1st of last year. So if you haven't heard about that, those design values for southern pine changed, and there's a lot of information on our website that goes through that as well. So column design, columns and posts, because those are for the most part almost completely unsupported by any kind of lateral brace. You might have a knee brace at the top of the post, and we've accounted for that now in the design process, but because they're for the most part fully unsupported, to do a post design, you got to know your tributary area that it's carrying based on the floor or the deck load above. And then from that, using compression parallel values and modulus of elasticity values, you can calculate your post height. And so the analysis procedure that's in the NDS looks at both axes or both the strong and the weak axis to calculate buckling and therefore the strength capacity of that column. So there's some other tools that you can use for that. Woodworks has some software that you can use, and that will allow you to size posts, but again, you have to calculate the tributary area for that, so you have to know how to enter your loads into the beam or the column module in Woodworks. 6x6 is the minimum. 8x8 can be used based on the commentary and the notes to the new table in DCA 6 for post heights. But that DCA 6 commentary will give you a lot more insight into how those calculations are done and what your options are for 8x8s. It's much more limited now, and especially for 4x4 columns, because we are accounting for the possibility that you're going to have a knee brace, or not the possibility, but the probability that you're going to have a knee brace at the top of that post. And that knee brace is actually going to add an additional concentrated load near the top of the post as that deck moves and the knee brace kicks in, or diagonal brace, we call it a knee brace, but the diagonal brace near the top. And so that actually affects the capacity of that column. And so that's all accounted for now. And so that's why we say in the document that for your center posts, and before I jump into beam design, I just want to finish that thought. For center posts, where you've got maybe a diagonal brace coming in from two different directions, you've actually got twice the load on that post at the top. And so we're going to try and keep knee braces off of opposite sides of that center post to keep from doubling up that load at the top of that center post. So just take a look closely at that change to DCA 6. The beam and joist spans are based, again, on the type of species and grade of lumber that you have for your deck design, the cross-sectional size of the beam and the tributary load that it supports. And as we show in some of the figures in DCA 6, you are allowed to have cantilevers or overhangs here from the end of the post on either end. But if you are going to use built-up posts or members, you're going to want to make sure that those splices occur right across the post. You can't be splicing out here at some intermediate location because there's really not a design methodology for that. So any splices that occur have to be right across your posts. So we're going to check bending, shear, deflection, and bearing for those beams as well. And that's all done sort of in the background for DCA 6. We've sized the beams based on those design provisions. But the other thing you'll need to keep an eye on, although I don't think it's quite as common for decks as it is for floor joists and beams in the interior of a structure, but you do want to follow the same notching provisions that are shown for bending members, and that would prevent more than a quarter of the depth at the end of the bending member and only a sixth of the depth in the areas away from that end. And so those are coming right out of the IRC and NDS section 3.2.3 and would apply to decks just as much as they would apply to floor joists as well. So then we have one more document that I want to show you, and also mention that in June, when we have our next webinar, we're going to be talking about this document in a little more detail. But this is called Wood Structural Design Data. It's the red document here in the background. It's another one of those documents that's been around for decades. It's a free download from our website. If you just search WSDD on our website, you'll land on it. This document does provide column load tables, beam load tables. There's a supplement that you can download as a companion, the NDS supplement that can be downloaded as a companion to wood structural design data. And so we often get questions, since span tables for joists and rafters are so prevalent out there, what happens if I want to design a beam? Well, wood structural design data does give you a methodology to do that. It is it does require some calculations, some limited calculations, especially for the design values like we showed in the example earlier. But it does have examples in there as well that you can follow to allow you to size different beams and columns and based on the tributary area or load that's carried on those beams and columns. And so tune in next month in June if you want to learn a little bit more about that document. But again, it's a free download. Then we want to talk a little bit about connection design. The NDS does have a very comprehensive section, several chapters actually, on connection design, starting in Chapter 10 of the NDS. And so all the design equations for calculating not only nails and lag screws and bolts that are used in deck design, but we also have provisions for wood screws, and split rings and shear plates, timber rivets, and other types of fasteners that are used every day in the design process. Not only do we show the equations, but there are tables of those design values as well. And there are penetration requirements for many of the fasteners, many of the threaded fasteners and nails that you see. And so one of the reasons we've got a lag screw table in the DCA 6 is because lag screws actually have a penetration requirement that's not often met when putting the tip of the lag screw through a rim joist or a rim board of a house. And so the tests were done based on the fact that you didn't have that complete penetration, and that's why you have those empirical values spelled out in the IRC and in DCA 6, because if you were to try and calculate it and use NDS provisions, it doesn't actually calculate out. So just be aware that those are prescriptive tables in the DCA 6 and the IRC, and if you come into the NDS to do an engineered design, you'll have to be aware of those penetration requirements. Lauren mentioned spacing end and edge distance requirements as well, and so those actually increase, those spacing end and edge distance requirements increase with an increase in the diameter of your fastener. So if you go bigger than a half inch bolt, and we tabulate all the way up to 1 inch bolts and leg screws in the NDS, then your spacing end and edge distance requirements are going to increase. And so suddenly attaching that ledger, the deck ledger, to the rim board of the house becomes much more difficult because of those edge distance requirements. And those are really there to prevent splitting of the wood members around the connections. It's also going to require that you pre-drill in a lot of cases, depending on the diameter of the fastener, so that you don't get splitting. So these are things that have to be considered not only in the design process, but in the construction process as well. So you need to read the details around the installation provisions for lag screws to make sure that you're doing it right and not ending up with a compromised connection. So the other thing we'll talk about here in a second is tension perpendicular to grain, but the materials that are covered in the NDS include wood-to-wood connections, wood-to-steel connections, and wood-to-concrete connections. And so you can design everything from a wood member attached to another wood member all the way down to a sill plate on a concrete foundation to get design values for those connections. Here's an example of one of the connection tables from the NDS. Table 11A covers bolts for a single shear connection, so it's got one shear plane here on either side of the bolt. And this applies to sawn lumber or structural composite lumber with both members of identical specific gravity. And again, specific gravity is what's used. You see those specific gravities shown here at the top of the column headers. And those are going to be different depending on the species. Southern pines are 0.55, Doug fir larch at 0.5, and then other species in grades or species as well shown in the tables. Then you've got your main member and side member thickness. In this case, 1.5 to 1.5 inch connection. You've got your bolt diameter shown here, 1/2 inch all the way up to 1 inch. Then you've got a series of values shown here. Z parallel means that your wood members that are loaded here are loaded up so that the bolt is being loaded parallel to grain along the length of the member. If you were to turn that member around similar to what we show in the deck ledger application, you'd use this Z perp value because now both of your members are loaded up perpendicular to the grain. Your ledger and your rim board are both loaded perpendicular to grain. Then these intermediate values are shown here for Z S perp and ZM perp, which are just basically variations of your side member and your main member being loaded perpendicular to grain while the other member is loaded parallel to grain. So we cover all those conditions, and then there are even equations that show how to design a connection if you're at some angle to grain that is not necessarily parallel or perpendicular to grain. So that's covered as well. We try and make that easy also with the connection calculator that's free on our website. It covers single fasteners, calculates all six of those yield modes from the yield mode equations that we talked about. And you see here under connection yield modes, it spits out those calculated values, takes the smallest one that controls, in this case, for this particular fastener, 199 pounds, and says that's your adjusted allowable stress design capacity. But we also cover LRFD as well. So up here's where you choose ASD versus LRFD, your loading conditions, whether you've got a bolt, lag screw, or wood screw is shown here under fastener type. And then over here's where you can vary your species and different fastener properties. Again, to give a plug for our June webinar, we're going to be talking about this connection calculator in addition to wood structural design data, and we're also going to be talking about our span calculator and some of those tools that we mention every once in a while, but we've not at this point done a webinar. And so we want to give folks an opportunity to see how these calculators and some of these other design tools can be useful in your everyday work environment. I mentioned the parallel to grain versus perpendicular to grain applications. Again, this shows Z parallel, where both members are loaded parallel to grain. You see the spacing, the end distance, the spacing between bolts, the edge distance. And again, as these fastener diameters increase, these end and edge distances are also going to increase. So you have to pay attention to that. If you're doing a deck design outside of the prescriptive limits that we show, you're using larger diameter fasteners, you've got to make sure you can meet your end and edge distance provisions as well. Then we've got this particular case where you've got the beam or the wood member, side member loaded perpendicular to grain, and your post in this case loaded parallel to grain. So this is an example if you wanted to design a bolt connection like we showed in one of the earlier slides. It says don't do this. Well, that's because you're taking a pretty significant reduction in your bolt values because of wet service factors and other conditions. So if you were to actually design this connection per the NDS provisions and take those reduction factors that we'll show here in a second, you'll find out your capacity is going to be pretty limited. But it is something you can do with a pencil and calculator and your NDS in front of you. Let's talk just a little bit about tension perpendicular to grain, because we mentioned in previous slides that you need to be aware of this, not only for wood member connections, but also for wood members themselves, but for the connections that could create tension perpendicular to grain. So when you're notching a wood member, that can create tension perp issues. Large diameter fasteners that we talked about earlier could create that problem. Hanging loads off the bottom of a wood member or a ledger or a beam could create situations where tension perp is created, and shrinkage is also another one of those issues. So in NDS table 11.5.1c, we restrict loading in the tension zone because of that tension perpendicular to grain issue. And so if you have a ledger with a single row of fasteners, and if you go back to DCA 6, you'll notice that the ledger has staggered rows of fasteners to spread that load out along the length of this ledger. So, you know, you'll have a fastener here, and then, you know, 16 inches later you have a fastener down here. So we're going to stagger those fasteners so that we don't end up with a case where we're putting all the load into the single row of fasteners and creating a tension perpendicular to grain issue. And so, again, if you're looking at an engineered design, be aware of those restrictions and avoid tension perp. Here's that example where if we had a single row of fasteners along the length of this ledger here tied into a rim, right here at the top in this area above the bolts where you could create tension perpendicular to grain issues, because this is loaded above the neutral axis of the member. And so this is what you want to avoid, and that's why we show staggered rows of fasteners along the length of that ledger. This then gets us to a situation I was talking about earlier with wet service factors for bolts and other fasteners. So if you're above moisture content of 19% in service, and you've got, say, a whole group of fasteners in, for example, the beam to column application where you're attaching your deck beam to the post. We showed that group of connectors earlier. Well, because of tension perpendicular to grain issues, shrinkage, trying to avoid splitting of that bending member, take a serious reduction, a 60% reduction, a 0.4 factor that has to be applied to your bolt design values if you're in that particular application. It applies to lag screws as well, greater than a quarter inch diameter. And so the exception is if you only have one fastener or fasteners all in one row, or you've split up your fasteners across different load paths so that you don't have this tug of war going on with your bolts that might be here steel plate, if that were a solid steel plate, and this joist or bending member in the background started to dry down, well, the steel plate's not going to move. It's not going to shrink and swell with moisture content change. So these bolts are going to be held in place. So as that wood member dries down, it's going to create a tension perp issue right here where this line is shown. And so that's why we show conditions like this where you want to avoid situations that are going to lead to tension perp perpendicular to grain. That's why the severe reduction values to connection capacities. I mentioned earlier the woodwork software, and I'll put a disclaimer here that we don't have any financial interest in woodwork software. We are technical advisors to woodworks, and so if you're looking for additional tools that you can use in the design process, again, if you want to design cantilever beams or joists where you're not able to do that with the tools that we have available either on the website or in some of our documents, then software is a possibility. There is a discount for AWC members. Notice that they sell these modules separately now. So the sizer module that would allow you to size a beam with a cantilever would be at this price level. And it's been updated to the newest 2012 NDS standards that are out there. And so there's some links that you can use to get to some of those resources. So we're getting close to the end of the presentation, which is actually record time here that we've ever finished. So it looks like we're going to have plenty of time for Q&A, but I want to show you, again, links to some of the resources that are available out there that you looked at earlier. The DCA 612 is now available and posted online, so you can download that and begin to read through it and use it for your designs. And this is a link to the presentation that we're doing right now. Also want to mention that Wood Design Focus recently had about a year ago, summer of 2013, an issue devoted specifically to deck and deck construction, some of the research that's going on out there in the deck world. We are right now in a research project with Washington State University to try and get a better handle on some of those loading conditions. And what you see here is an actual test that was done at the university, at Washington State University, where they put a bunch of students on the deck and had them start to sway back and forth to some music, as you might imagine could very easily happen on a college campus. And they found out that the loads are very high based on a circumstance like this. They actually eclipsed the wind and seismic loads that were used to design the same deck. And so in this Wood Design Focus issue, they'll look at a wind load analysis, a seismic load analysis, and then they look at the occupant loads and show that those occupant loads, as I mentioned earlier, eclipse any wind or seismic loads on a deck under normal circumstances. So that's why you're seeing changes in the evolution of DCA 6 and the building code, the IRC, because we know these occupant loads are much higher than we had ever envisioned before. And those loading conditions are actually also being submitted to ASCE 7. And so you'll see in the next few years probably some lateral load conditions for decks that accommodate this type of situation. So we're really excited about that research and what's happening there. We're hoping that'll give us some really good data to apply to developing these deck provisions. We're working with Washington State and our partners at ICC and Fairfax County and the NADRA, North American Deck and Railing Association, other building officials that are involved in some of the IRC development, deck development provisions, to try and put some things together that are sound, have a sound research basis, but also have some fairly practical applications as well. So that's a little bit about research that's going on out there. Again, some more links for you. Hopefully Brian's posting those up for you, and all of these are available free on our website. I will mention this one pager here, this third link down. We get requests a lot. Can I post DCA 6 to my building department website? And our response is typically to guide folks to this one pager. And this one pager has the link to DCA 612. What we'd like to avoid is having a lot of different copies of DCA 6 out there that we just can't keep up with. If every building department in the country did that, we'd have 20,000 versions of DCA 6 floating around out there. And so what we're recommending is that you put this one pager up on your website, which directs folks specifically to DCA 6 on our website. And that gives you the assurance that any new changes that come about, and there are constantly, we're seeing changes as we did last year to Southern Pine design values, for example. So we had to come out with a new addendum to the DCA 6 to account for those changes to Southern Pine design values. Well, if anyone has the old DCA 6 out there on their website, they don't have access at this point to those new design values. And so we want to make sure that you're always updated with the latest information. And so that's why we recommend this one pager. If you want to post something to our website, it shows you the disclaimer and copyright notice that allows you to do that. And that should make life much easier for you and your customers, so you're always getting the latest and greatest information. So hopefully that helps with that question and heading that question off. So I'm going to ask Marcy to come back, because as we continue to develop tools that you can use for deck design and construction, someone's asked whether or not we think a pocket guide would be useful. And so we want to get your input, since we have several hundred of you captive here today, to see if a pocket guide would be useful for you. So I'll ask Marcy to open up that poll and let's see what kind of results we get back.
All righty. Go ahead. A bunch of you already started, so I'm going to let you go ahead. 67% have already voted, so we're going to go until about 80% have voted. All right, I'm going to go ahead and close that. Buddy, I guess about 77% think that that would be useful.
Excellent. Well, that's very helpful feedback for us, and something that we can now take to folks who've been helping us with DCA 6. And now I'm going to ask Lauren, if he would, to come back on. And while he's coming, I'm going to pull out some of the questions that we've been receiving, and Lauren will field some of those, and then I'll jump in whenever necessary to field some questions as well. So go ahead and fire off your questions to us.
Okay. The first question is, where can they find the commentary?
Oh, very, very good question. It's often overlooked at the very back of DCA 6. So Lauren has been working diligently on that commentary for the 2012 edition. We're not quite finished yet, so that one's coming in a couple of weeks. But if you want to get a sneak peek at the 2009 version, if you download the 2009 version of DCA 6, go past page 20, and you're going to find that that commentary is back there at the back of the 2009 version of DCA 6, and it gives a lot of the background information that we've been talking about here today.
Yeah, we're hoping to get that commentary out as soon as possible. That was another question, is when that commentary is going to be available. So as soon as possible is the answer to that. Buddy talked a little bit about how to adopt DCA 6 for the local jurisdictions. It's that one pager. Maybe you could show them that link again to it.
And I'm going to ask Brian, if he will, to post that again. It's in your chat box, folks, so take a look there. I think you can directly hit that link in the chat box, and that'll take you to the one pager. And so it's the second one up that I'm seeing right now in the chat box.
Yep. And let's see, where can they find the NDS that you were talking about?
Okay, the NDS is available to purchase on our website. That's unfortunately one of those documents that's not free. It is one of our ANSI standards, and so the standards that we take through that ANSI consensus process, we need to continue to generate some revenues to continue that standards development process here. So that one is available to purchase. There are some discounts available to our members, but if you go to our website, awc.org, and either search NDS or right there on the home page or the codes and standards page, I guess, you should see a link to the NDS, and you can get either an electronic or hard copy version of that. And Lauren, let me jump in here now, because I'm seeing folks saying, well, if it wasn't a, you know, you guys didn't go 2 hours, are we still going to get our credit? And
yeah.
So I think we're going to provide as much credit as we can. The Q&A session actually counts, so we're going to continue to take questions and answers here for as long as we can, as long as those roll in and it's helpful, and that also counts towards your certification. So if we go a half an hour of questions, you'll get your full 2 hour certifications. And Lauren, I see one here that asks about the allowable overhang length increasing as joist spacing increases. I know you worked on those tables. You want to take a first shot at that one, and then I'll maybe follow up?
Yeah, it's kind of an anomaly. It's counterintuitive to how they look. It's because of two phenomena that is going on, that are going on simultaneously. Basically, what we did is we said we figured out what the maximum simple span is for those joists, and then we said, okay, how far of an overhang can you go? And we figured out how far of an overhang you can go based on that 40 PSF and then also on that 220 point load. And so you have to look at it as how far can those span tables be with the back span. So having a larger back span might mean that you might have a shorter overhang that's allowable. And so it's a kind of a counterintuitive as far as the direction of which those might go. But yeah, it does look funny for sure.
Yeah, and I'll add one other thing, and it's also that we have an L over 4 provision that either overrides or could potentially kick in as well. And so you may see an overhang getting truncated at L over 4, which will make a difference in when you're comparing spans or overhang cantilever spans as well.
Yep, that's true. Okay. Let's see, another one was, the lateral load device requires the floor sheeting to be nailed inside the house. How can this be done in an existing house with a finished floor over the sheathing?
Very, very good question. There are a couple of different approaches there that we've been hearing about. If the basement or the area underneath the floor is open, one option that we've seen is to use clip angles or brackets to attach the joist to the sheathing, and that helps get that diaphragm get your load back into the diaphragm. So instead of tearing up tiles up top or some kind of flooring up top and nailing additional nails through the sheathing into the joist, come from the underside and put some clip angles onto the joist up into the sheathing. And the fastener manufacturers out there are very happy to provide those types of clip angles for you. And Lauren will also be providing some commentary that talks about what the assumptions are as far as load and getting that. It's basically getting that 1,500 pound point load from that hanger back through those joists and sheathing to make sure that you've got load transfer between the joists and the sheathing to accommodate that 1,500 pounds. And Lauren, I don't know if you've seen any other details as you've been working through this document or not that can help accommodate that you want to share.
Not really. It's always been a pain to do that 1,500 pound. I've seen people try to work around it, but the IRC pretty much stipulates that 1,500 pound. So people have worked around it, but there's never been any real testing method or they've always kind of gone by the thumb of saying, well, that's roughly equivalent. So I'm not sure how well those methods work or not. It's just they've been unproven so far. They might work better. I don't know.
Okay. Let me jump to the next question. I see one here. Does the IRC specifically prohibit notching 4x4 guard posts? Great question. That's actually something that's been proposed several times to the IRC and to this point has not passed the membership votes and committee votes. So at this point, that is prescribed in DCA 6, and that is a limit that our members and engineers stand behind because we know what we see with notching those 4x4 posts at the base. The issue has to do with that 200-pound point load at the top of the post, and Lauren showed some of the research that went behind this, and that's on a huge cantilever arm. A 36-inch cantilever arm is the length of your post. So now you've got a 200-pound load at the top of a 36-inch cantilever, and that puts a very large moment at the base of the guard post. And it the wood member, and remember I talked about tension perpendicular to grain, where you've created a perfect path for tension perpendicular to grain at that corner of that notch. And so once you load that up, it will split right up the length of the post, and that's what's been failing in a lot of cases. Other failures include nailing the guard posts or not adequately fastening them to the exterior of the rim or of the deck. But that's why Virginia Tech went to such great lengths, Virginia Tech and Washington State, to test all kinds of different configurations of posts. And they just couldn't get the traditional notched, couple of lag screws in the face of the post condition to work. They kept splitting out either the post or the connections. And so that's why you see that big hold-down connector at the bottom of the post. It's the only one at this point that they could get to work on the generic materials, the treated lumber and lag screws. There are likely deck railing manufacturers out there that have evaluation reports. I know Virginia Tech continues to test products, and so you can look at different options in the evaluation reports to see what's out there to handle that 200-pound point load. But I know that's a long-winded answer to notching. Can you notch a guard post or not, or is that covered in the IRC? It's not specifically, but you just don't want to do it. You don't want to go there.
The only thing I would add is that one of the biggest reasons it's not in the IRC is one of the biggest issues that had when it was proposed to the IRC was that they didn't want to see a single system being put into the IRC. Currently, the IRC doesn't specify that you even have to have posts, and so why would we say you can't notch something that you don't even have to have? Well, it's kind of this issue of a method versus the method philosophy, and so there's that issue of we don't want to necessarily put in code something that's going to say the method. And
correct.
And so there was that hesitation behind it.
Right. Jump to the next question here. There's a point about truss, connecting decks to trusses, and that several of the truss design firms out there have details that you can show. And it says, how come you do not accept those engineered type details? It's really builds on what you just said, Lauren. We don't prohibit those details in any way. We say that if you go to those specific details, you turn those over to your building official in the design or the permit process, then working with your building official, if those are signed by a registered design professional, those should be perfectly acceptable to the building official. So there could be an inspection issue that they're worried about if they can't see those trusses inside, but if the details accommodate that and allow for visual inspection of the connections, then that is not in any way prohibited by DCA 6.
No. Here's another question. Why does the railing post connection detail, while we're talking about railings, only show a hold-down connector at the top when the railing load is in any direction? Therefore, the connector could be at the top or the bottom.
Show hold down at the top.
Basically, he's asking why is that hold down tension device on the railing only for the top bolt instead of for the top and the bottom bolt?
Oh, I see. Okay, that's a great question. Here's a bit of a secret to DCA 6 that you need to be aware of. We are at this point only accounting for the lateral load pushing out away from the deck. We're not at this point accounting for pulling the railing back in toward the deck. The real danger to occupants of decks is going off the edge once you get above that threshold of 30 inches or whatever it is in the IRC and in DCA 6. So we had to, again, balance practicality with design in this process and came to the conclusion, along with folks that were on our task group, that designing for an inward 200-pound load, an outward 200-pound load is the direction we need to take. That inward load, while the deck railing could fail, at worst, you're going to fall down on your tailbone and maybe have a bruise. But we'd rather protect folks from toppling off the edge of the deck onto some concrete patio below or some other situation where a lot more bodily harm could occur.
Here's one, while we're still talking about railings, that I actually got asked just the last week. So you can't notch that 4x4 post, right? Well, what happens if I have a 6x6 post? Can I notch that and leave the 4x4 remaining material there? Wouldn't that work?
Again, you'll want to approach that with your building official, and we'll have to think through that one a little bit here. You're still going to have to use those hold down devices at the base, as we've discussed.
My gut reaction was no, because you're gonna still have that stress concentration there.
You are, and the other issue that you have to account for is the fact that the 4x4 posts are going to have different design values than the 6x6 posts. Because those are tabulated in two different places in the NDS supplement, you're going to have to check your design values to make sure that they're comparable. And so the more I'm talking about this and thinking about it, the more I'm thinking that's probably going to have to be an engineered design. But as with many of the things that work their way into DCA 6, that's certainly something that we can look at and looked for or looked to accommodate maybe in the 2015 version, because we are already, as you know, as we're putting 2012 to bed and getting it available out there, going to begin the process for developing the 2015 version, because the 2015 IRC provisions have already been completed. So what else do we have, Lauren?
Is there a table to determine the sizing of the hold-down tension device at the ledger based on deck size? That's kind of an interesting question for a from the standpoint of it, that the IRC isn't based on that 1,500 pounds, isn't based off deck size. It just says 1,500 pounds. So there isn't, because there is no such thing as a, what Dr. Bender's research at Washington State University showed is that the people load on decks is what's really going to govern. The seismic load, the wind load, isn't going to really what's going to govern. And so, and there's nothing that's prescribed as far as what people load has. So you don't really know what the loads on the deck necessarily are. So you end up with this, we know that there's an issue, but we don't necessarily know how much of that load needs to be taken care of. So we don't know how to size for, currently how to size for a hold down tension device per the deck, because we don't know. That's part of the research that we're hoping to do with Dr. Bender at Washington State University, is to try to figure out how do different aspect ratios, how do different sizes, how does different decking orientation, how do those hidden fasteners, how does all that come into play so that you can figure out what do those hold down tension devices do when they're needed.
Yep. Yeah, we're really excited about that research and what it might provide for us for this next 2015 edition. Here's a real simple one that we just got last week on our help desk. Why can't carriage bolts be used? That's a great question, and the answer is that at this point in the ASME standards, the ANSI ASME standards, they have standards to govern the manufacture of lag screws and bolts and carriage bolts. But unfortunately, those standards for carriage bolts aren't as well defined, and we have not at this point been able to incorporate carriage bolt design values or design properties into the NDS because they're not as well defined. However, if you have a proprietary manufacturer that has carriage bolts, and they can provide properties for those carriage bolts that are comparable to a regular bolt, an ANSI ASME bolt that we specify in the NDS, and you'll see those standards referenced at the front of DCA 6 as well, then a carriage bolt could potentially be substituted. But again, that's going to be something you have to work out with your building official and may require some engineering design. Lauren, there's one about if your aspect ratio exceeds 1:1, how about installation of lateral ties in, say, the middle of the deck? And I think we had talked about that as we were developing this latest version of DCA 6. Can you comment on that? Are you developing commentary for that?
Yeah, basically what's going on is that aspect ratio comes out of the special design provisions for wind and seismic. So what it is the diaphragm aspect ratio of that. So there's a couple ways in which you can kind of get around that 1:1 aspect ratio. The easiest way is probably to actually go from horizontal decking to diagonal decking. And the commentary will specify that you can say, hey, diagonal decking will give you up. And I think it'll give you up to a 1.5 is what the commentary is going to probably say. And that's going to make it so that it's just the nature of the diagonal decking is stiffer and stronger. So it acts as a diaphragm. Now, when you say the lateral devices, I assume you're talking about those 1,500-pound hold-down devices kind of in the middle of the deck. Is that what you're taking it as?
That's correct. Those 1,500-pound hold-downs right now, and that builds on another question. Now, two of those are required on every deck out at the, you know, close to the edges of the deck, and that's another thing we don't really clearly specified. It's not specified in the IRC.
No.
They are required at the edges.
So I'm trying to figure out how that would work here.
And if the answer at this point is, you know, we don't know, and we're going to be working on that for 2015, that's a good enough answer.
Yeah.
So we can get to some of the other questions.
Yeah. It's my problem is that if you divide it, your deck needs to be wider. It needs to be wider than it is long, right? So dividing it in half would actually make that aspect ratio worse, So I'm not sure exactly how that helps.
Okay, so I'm thinking the answer to that one. Stay tuned for the 2015 version.
Yeah. As we think it through.
All right. Hey, here's one about beam. Cantilever, LSB over 4 maximum. Is that the actual span LSB or the post spacing? And I think those are the same thing, right?
It's actually from the post face to post face.
Okay.
In 2012, we tried to make it super easy for the builder who's actually going to construct the deck. So we changed the definition of a span a little bit. If you look at the definition of span in the NDS, it's like 1/2 the bearing length of something, of the required bearing length or something along those lines. And so it's really hard to, you know, you have to do calculations to figure out what the actual span rating is. So what we did is we just said, look, let's just go face to face and we'll adjust the numbers to make it so it's built into the table so that it works out. So the beam span is the actual span of face-to-face and post.
Okay, good. I'm going to come back again to the aspect ratio just to clarify that the width must be greater than the length. So the width is the dimension along the side of the house.
Yep.
And the length is the projection from the house, perpendicular to the house.
Yep.
And so we want to think of it and used a good analogy of nose on your face. Think of it in terms of a fishing pier. We don't want a fishing pier on the back of our house. That becomes very unstable out, you know, sticking out the end of a house. It's like a big, tall cantilever flagpole or something like that. So we want a short, stout beam, sort of like a beam attached to the side of the house, and so it's going to be the dimensions either square or rectangular, with the long dimension being parallel to the house.
Basically, we like short, stubby noses, not long, thin noses.
And is the 1,500-pound requirement for those hold downs for both hold downs combined? It's for each hold down. Each hold down has to be a 1,500-pound hold down on two sides near the edge of the deck. There's another one about the use of structural screws instead of half-inch lags, and that falls under that. You know, if it's approved, an approved fastener with an evaluation report, and the building officials accept it, we know those proprietary lag screws are used all over the place, and so DCA 6 does not prohibit the use of those proprietary fasteners.
Are beams girders required to run perpendicular to the joist, or can they run at a diagonal as well? That's kind of an interesting question. I don't see any reason as to say why they couldn't run at a diagonal as long as you don't overspan the joists.
Right. So you'd have to still make sure that the tricky part there would be calculating your tributary area. And so
yeah.
That one might take a little bit of analysis and back and forth with your building department, but based on the commentary that you're developing and the tributary area table that you're developing, Lauren, I think that's something that could potentially be done as
yeah.
an alternate with the building official, in conjunction with the building official.
Yeah.
But you have to be careful about your tributary area and your largest unsupported lengths for your beams and your joists.
Yeah, exactly. You might end up with a slightly oversized footer if you went in with the DCA 6 with the largest spans on both, but you could probably do it.
All right, working my way down through a few more questions here. And hey, wow, we've got time for one more question. Looks like folks are going to get their 2-hour credit. So let's take one more here, Lauren, if you saw one that you want to try and pick off here for us to finish up with, and then we'll ask Marcy to come back.
Okay, let's see. In high seismic areas, are knee braces permitted? When do I design knee braces? Or when I do design knee braces are extremely hard to design.
Oh, boy, you had to pick the hardest one for last, didn't you?
I did. I try to pick good ones for you, buddy.
Okay, here's the deal with knee braces. They are very hard to design, and Lauren found that out as we went through this latest process. And so right now, we've got them prescriptively included in the DCA 6. I think what we're going to find with research at Washington State and some of the other additional calculations that we're going to be running is that those aren't going to be as effective as maybe some other methods for stabilizing, providing lateral stability to the deck. Lauren mentioned the diagonal decking on top, which is probably the most effective way to stiffen it up. But I think you're going to find that that's going to sort of fall out of our research here in the next couple of months, and that'll give us a little better handle on what we do with knee braces.
Yeah, and that's also why DCA 6 requires those lateral devices. It requires them, and it doesn't actually rely on the knee bracing for lateral restraint. Those knee braces
right.
are just there for stiffness. It's not actual the load path per se,
Great.
The main primary load path.
Great. All right, well, we have hit our 2-hour mark, and so I'm going to ask Marcy to come back if she will and finish us up with a couple of logistic and housekeeping items.
All right, absolutely. Just, I'm sure you've had a chance to read this, and many of you already know that we provide wood design and construction information to assist the building industry. Let me go on to you have to move me on. We provide technical expertise, education, and support building codes and standards and wood engineering design issues. And then before I lose you, I need to remind you that I'm going to be sending out an email today, probably within the next hour. And in that email, I'll have a survey link that we'd like you to fill out. There's only 6 questions on it. It'll take you 2 or 3 minutes, and we'd really appreciate your feedback. You can win a free publication, and also in that email is information about your certificates of completion. You will be getting those within 2 weeks. I will be processing those, and you'll get them within 2 weeks. Remember that you must have been present today for 90% of this webinar. That's 108 minutes, so in order to receive that certificate, 108 minutes. If there's been more than one of you in the conference room, I know I've already received several of these, but I need the multiple attendees form, and Brian's been sending that out. He's sending it out again. If you're interested in more education events with us, go go to our website at www.awc.org. Send us an email at education@awc.org. Don't forget about, we've talked about it before earlier today, AWC's web-based calculators and other resources webinar next month, June 24th. And also Buddy and Michelle are teaching at Virginia Tech on the weekend of September 24th to the 26th, Prescriptive and Engineering Design per the 2012 WFCM Seminar. Love to see you there. We're glad you were with us today. Have a great weekend. We'll talk to you later.